वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला फिलॉसफी। आई एम सच्चिदानंद मिश्र, प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिलॉसफी एंड रिलीजन, बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी। एंड द मॉड्यूल आई एम गोइंग टू प्रेजेंट हियर इज द पूर्व पक्ष एक्सप्लेनेशन ऑफ व्याप्ति, एंड दिस मॉड्यूल इज प्रिपेयर्ड बाय मी। So in this module, we will discuss some certain issues which are very much related to Vyapti. And if we say, what are the necessary things to infer? An inference arises if there are two cognitions. So we can say that two cognitions are very much required in order to inferential process take place. And these two cognitions are the cognition of Vyapti and that of Pakshadharmata. So in this module we are going to discuss what is the nature of Vyapti and how this nature of Vyapti got modified in a course of time, why it was formulated in a different way first and after it was formulated in a totally different way, and how these ideas got changed in the course of time. All this we will be explaining in this way. So here Purvapaksha Vyapti is being going to be explained, and why it is called the Purvapaksha. The Purvapaksha means, Purv means prior, Paksha means position, so it means prior position. So the prior position adapted on Vyapti, adapted about the nature of Vyapti, is known as Purvapaksha Vyapti. And the position which is not only, why this position was prior adopted, it means it was prior adopted but later was given up. Why? Because it could not stand against scrutiny. If these explanations were examined, then it was found that they are defective, and if it is found that they are defective, so they cannot be accepted, they should be given up. Therefore many definitions, many formulations, many explanations of Vyapti were proposed and they were given up by others, and we do not know who proposed which definition, which explanation, because in Indian philosophical tradition it is not a traditional way of saying. At that time it was not said clearly that who proposed this view, but they were collected in text. We find that certain views are collected in views like by Shashadhar, by Manikantha Mishra and by Gangesho Upadhyaya. So in all these texts many views are formulated, and that view which could satisfy the reasoning, which can sustain after scrutiny, that position was taken to be the Siddhanta Paksha, to the conclusive position, and that was accepted. So it leaves the room that if one finds now in that Siddhanta Paksha any defect, that Siddhanta Paksha would turn to be Purva Paksha at all, and thereafter another Siddhanta Paksha would come. So let us first in a brief way understand why in Nyaya tradition this kind of reasoning started, and in that way we can see that Navya Nyaya was actually a Nyaya, a response to Sriharsha. Because in Khandan Khandakhadya, Sriharsha raised some destructive arguments in order to refute the Nyaya philosophical doctrines. But the Nayayikas never gave up. They started formulating newer and newer positions one after another, and they rejected the old ones if they found some defects, and proposed new theory in the hope that the new theory will be free from the defects which was found in last definition, last explanation. So we find Shashadhar Mishra, Manikantha Mishra, Gangesha Upadhyay, all these scholars doing these exercises. And we can see that Gangesha has collected those positions which were formulated, proposed by other scholars. Manikantha Mishra also proposed those positions which were collected and propounded by others. And in the course of time, those positions were taken and they were analyzed and they scrutinized, and thereafter they were given up if it is found that they cannot be free from defects. So here we can see what are these Purupaksha explanations of Vyapti. And actually, these are not definitions of Vyapti, but these are explanations of Vyapti. These are the meanings of Vyapti. In that way, Vyapti is understood by these philosophers. Therefore, this is actually the explanation of nature of Vyapti. So, Shashadhara, we find Shashadhara Mishra explaining, presenting 17 Purupaksha Vyaptis. Manikantha Mishra formulated more than 10 theories, 10 positions, and Gangesh propounded 21 positions in his Tattva Chintamani. And all those Vyaptis focus on the explanation of Vyapti, what is the nature of Vyapti, and the basic point was taken in this all discussion, and those basic points were simply two things were. One is Abhyavichari Tattva and another was Avinabhava. So Abhyavichari Tattva was accepted as Purapaksha Vyapti and Avinabhava was accepted as a Purapaksha Vyapti. But the point is that how to understand this Abhyavichari Tattva. Abhyavichari Tattva has two parts. Vyavichari Tattva means Vyavichara and A means negation. Negation of Vyavichara. So Vyavichara means deviation and Avyavichara means not deviation. So non-deviation or not deviation, whatever you say. So this non-deviation, if you give this word, it is completely in a confusing area. It cannot be understood what is the meaning of it. So it needs a proper explanation, and the proper explanation, what is the meaning of non-deviation? If it is said, if it is asked, one has to explain what is the nature of deviation. And when you say that this is the nature of deviation, the opposite of that is non-deviation. The absence of that is non-deviation. So here Gangesha Upadhyay proposes five different meanings of Abhyavichari Tattva, non-deviation. But he finds none of them suitable for the very simple reason that in the case of inference known as Kevala Anvayi, none of them could apply to that inference. And they were not satisfactory for this ground, and he gave up those definitions. In this chapter, we will first take, because as I had explained just a few minutes ago, that there are so many definitions and it would be impossible to explain, discuss all those discussion explanations. So I will make myself limited to only these five definition explanations and one or two more explanations, because it will give the idea of Purupaksha Vyapti. And simply these are, whenever we study Purupaksha Vyapti, simply we try to study only these five parts of definition, and the chapter in which these five explanations are found is known as Panchalakshani or Vyapti Panchak Prakaran of the Tattva Chintamani. So first explanation of Vyapti is Sadhyabhavavad Avrititva. And if we keep into consideration the idea of indirect relation, this can be understood in that term, that sadhya bhava avrittitva, we begin with sadhya and reach to hetu. And if there is a break, if we are able to reach to hetu, it means this is applicable to hetu. There is vyapti. If it applies to hetu, then we can say that it is good. And if it is not applicable to hetu, there is a defect in it. And in order to evaluate whether a given explanation of vyapti is correct or not correct, we have some criteria. And those criteria are that one criteria, first criterion is that it must be applicable to all those cases which are taken to be the good examples, sound examples of sound inference. So if those are the examples of sound inference, then and it is applicable to that, it is the first necessity. And if it is, these are not applicable to, if any one of these explanations is not applicable to the sound cases of inference, then we have to conclude that this explanation is not correct at all. It is not applicable to all those definendum which should have been covered by this explanation. Secondly, that these should not be applicable to those cases of inference which are not taken to be the sound cases of inference, sound examples of inference. So these are two basic needs, and if these two basic needs are fulfilled, then we should take that this explanation is correct and it satisfies. So we will take some examples here in this chapter, in this module, to understand whether a given explanation is applicable to it or not. So first of all, we will take the example which is very famous example, the Parvataha Vanniman Dhuman. Mountain has smoke. In mountain there is smoke because there is fire. So here fire is taken to be proved, fire is sadhya, and smoke is taken to be hetu because smoke is perceived, smoke is siddha there, it is proved through perception, and mountain is paksha where we are going to prove the presence of sadhya. So in this case we have to observe whether this explanation is applicable to or not. So here sadhya bhava, what is sadhya bhava avrittitva, the explanation is given. So what is the meaning of this explanation? Let us understand first. Sadhya bhava, the absence of sadhya. What means adhikaran, substratum, locus? So sadhya bhava adhikaran nisht. Nisht means present. Sadhya bhavavat avrittitva means sadhya bhavavat means sadhya bhavadhikaran, the substratum or the locus of the absence of sadhya. In that locus, this hetu should not be present, should be absent. So if this is the case, this is the criteria, this is the point must be applicable to the cases of sound inferences. So Parvata Vanniman Dhumat, mountain has fire because it has smoke. This is the example of sound inference. In this case we can see that sadhya is fire, the absence of fire is present. What is the adhikaran? What is the locus where the absence of fire is? We can observe that there are many cases like lake, like river, like sea. In all these places, the absence of fire is there. So in those cases, smoke is not present. Smoke is absent. It means it is fulfilling the criteria. It is fulfilling the need. It was the need of this explanation that Hetu must not be present in the locus of the absence of Sadhya. This simple point is explained in this Purvapaksha Vyapti. And it is the case here that smoke is absent in the locus of fire, the absence of fire. Therefore, we can say that this explanation is applicable to this case. Second example we will take. If we turn the table and try to infer a smoke in the mountain and propose fire as Hetu, what will happen then? And we can observe that this is not the case of a sound inference, because you can infer the presence of fire on the basis of smoke, but you cannot infer the presence of smoke on the basis of fire, because it is not the case that if there is fire, there must be smoke. But this is the case that if there is a smoke, there must be fire. So if you are inferring fire in the mountain on the basis of smoke, your inference is a sound one. But if you are doing differently, if you are inferring smoke in the mountain on the basis of fire, it is not good. It is not a good case of inference. It is not the sound case of inference. And here it should not be applicable to. And here we can see that it doesn't apply to it, because there are many places like modern kitchen. In our in modern kitchen, there we don't find any smoke at all, but we find fire. Okay, so if there is a red hot iron ball, if an iron ball is put in the fire and taken out from the fire, it will burn our hand. It means in that iron ball there is a fire, but there is no smoke at all. So in this case, if you try to go from beginning to Hetu, there will be a break. You cannot reach to fire if you start from moving this from the place smoke. Because smoke is taken as sadhya, the absence of sadhya, absence of smoke. Where is the smoke, absence of smoke? There are many cases, and among those cases, among those places, one place is that which is modern kitchen. Another place is there which is the red hot iron ball, where there is no smoke at all. So this is the locus of absence of smoke, and in that hot iron ball there is no absence of fire. This is to say there is presence of fire, there is no absence of fire. There should have been no absence of fire, there should have been absence of fire, but actually this is not the case. There is absence of fire, but actually there is no absence of fire. The fire is present in that hot iron ball. Therefore, this is not satisfied. This condition is not satisfied here. Sadhya bhavad avrittitva is not satisfied here. So it is not applicable to unsound inference. In this way, if we take examples, there is very interesting example provided by commentators on Tattva Chintamani, and that very interesting example is that if one infers, and this is taken to be in this example of a sound inference, there is a tree, and on that tree always there are monkeys, and one day one is moving from the side of tree and he is not seeing any monkey at all on that tree, because he is not able to see all those branches. He can see only the roots of that tree, and seeing the roots of that tree, the person says, okay, vrikshaha kapi sanyogi etad vrikshatvat, ayam vrikshaha kapi sanyogi etad vrikshatvat. This tree is endowed with the conjunction of monkey. This tree is conjoined with monkey because this is the same tree. Etad vrikshatva, the sameness, same tree-ness is proposed as hetu, and here the conjunction of monkey is proposed as sadhya, that is to be proved here, that is sadhya, and this tree is taken to be the paksha. And in this case, let us try to apply this definition, this explanation, whether it applies to this explanation or not. But before we try to apply this explanation, we must remember one point. And that point is that conjunction is a separate, a special kind of quality. A special kind of quality in the sense, actually it should not be confused with special quality, because there are in Vaisheshik philosophy there are two kinds of qualities, special qualities and general qualities. Conjunction is not a special quality, but it has some speciality, and the speciality of conjunction is that if it is present somewhere, it doesn't occupy the whole place at all. It is to say, it is a abhyapya vritti. It doesn't cover the whole substratum to be present there. Suppose if we take the example of inherence, the threads and cloth, between them there is a relation inherence. So if you ask whether the cloth is present in threads, in what part of this thread cloth is present, you cannot say that in this part there is a cloth and in that part there is no cloth at all. If you ask about movements, action in the fan, so you cannot say that whether there is a movement and whether there is no movement at all. So these qualities are present there, and they complete the whole locus, they cover the whole locus. Therefore, they are called vyapya vritti. But this is a kind of quality which doesn't cover the whole locus, but covers only a part of locus. So you can observe very easily that monkey can be present on the branches and can be absent on the roots at the same time. So if you take this definition, this explanation to apply in this case, you can see, you can observe very clearly that we have to start from sadhya, and sadhya is here actually kapi sanyog, the conjunction of monkey. So the conjunction of monkey is taken to be sadhya, and the absence of conjunction of monkey is there on the roots, because the monkey is not sitting on the roots, the monkey is sitting on the branches. So there is the absence of conjunction of monkey on the roots, and in those roots also the same tree-ness is present. It is not absent there, and it was the need that it must be absent in the locus where sadhya is absent. So here the criteria is not fulfilled, and sadhya bhava, sadhya bhavad avrittitva, avrittitva, non-occurrence. Non-occurrence is not there, because it is occurring, it is present there at the same place where there is the absence of sadhya is. So in this case, we cannot say that it is applicable to this example also, and this example is taken to be the case of good example, inference, sound inference, the case of sound inference. So here Mathuranath Bhattacharya, commentator on Tattva Chintamani, suggests that to get rid of this difficulty, we have to add one point in this definition, and that one point is that we have to say that the adhikaran of sadhya bhava, the locus of the absence of sadhya should be taken as niravachinna. Niravachinna means an unlimited locus. So when you are taking the locus of the absence of conjunction of monkey and the same tree is not unlimited locus, because this absence is not present in the whole tree. You can observe that the conjunction is present in the branches. So you cannot say that the absence of this conjunction is present in the whole tree, but in parts it is present and completely it is not present. So in this case, it would not be the substratum, the locus of absence which could be caught here for the to apply this definition. We have to find out another another locus which is actually so. The according to Mathuranatha, there are two things applicable now. The locus which is taken to be the locus of the thing which is taken to be the locus of absence of sadhya, that must be unlimited locus of absence of sadhya. So that same tree is not unlimited locus of absence of conjunction of monkey, therefore that tree cannot be grasped here. Another example should be taken, another thing should have been taken here. And if we take another thing, that is quality. In qualities, there is no quality at all. According to Nayayikas, qualities cannot be present in qualities. Conjunction cannot be present in any quality, not only in conjunction. So any quality if you take, that would be the locus of unlimited locus of the absence of conjunction of monkey, and there in that quality there is no etad brikshatva present. The same treeness is not present there. Therefore, this definition, this explanation is now applicable to this example also. So now there is no problem in this case. And now we turn to second definition, second explanation of second meaning of abhyavicharitattva. And this second meaning of abhyavicharitattva is sadhyavad bhinna sadhyabhavad avrittitva. And you can observe that in this explanation, the whole first explanation is taken into consideration, but only one part is also added, that is sadhyavad bhinna. And the greatest commentator on Tattva Chintamani, Raghunath Shiromani, says that Ganges proposed this second explanation of abhyavicharitattva to resolve the problem we were discussing now. And to resolve that problem, Mathuranath included that should be niravachinna adhikarana, unlimited locus of absence of sadhya is required. But Ganges himself tried to resolve the issue taking another way around, and he said that this absence of sadhya which is taken now, it must be present in sadhyavad bhinna. It must be present other than the locus of sadhya. And if you are taking the same tree is the locus of sadhya as well as the locus of absence of sadhya, because in the roots it is the locus of absence of sadhya, and on the trees it is the locus of sadhya, locus of conjunction of monkey. So it cannot be taken here, and if we do not take it, we have to take another place which could be taken as sadhyavad bhinna and sadhya bhavan. So sadhyavad bhinna and sadhya bhavan would be quality, and in those qualities etad brikshatva is absent. So the definition is applicable to it, and here there will be no difficulty at all, no problem at all. Third explanation is proposed, third meaning of abhyavicharitattva is proposed, saying that sadhyavat pratyogika anyonyabhava asamanadhikaranya. And this the meaning of this explanation is the province having no common locus, hetus having no common locus. Hetu is province. So province having no common locus with the mutual absence, whose counter positive is the locus of probandum. So in this case, or in other words, we can say that the province having the different locus from that of the mutual absence, of whose counter positive is the locus of probandum. So if we take the example, the sound example which was taken first earlier, a mountain has fire because it has smoke. Here in this case, mountain is paksha and fire is the sadhya, and sadhyavat pratyogik anyonya abhav we have to take. This is to say, simply saying, a counter positive of the locus of sadhya should be taken. This is to say, we would say that who is not the locus of fire? What is not the locus of fire? That should not be the locus of smoke at all, in simple way. And if this is the case, where there is no, that which is not the locus of fire, and when we say which is not the locus of fire, and in that place if there is hetu, then this hetu is not fulfilling this criteria, and if the hetu is absent there, then there will be asamanadhikarani. Asamanadhikarani word is used here. Asamanadhikarani means absence of samanadhikarani. Samanadhikarani means co-locatedness. This is to say, if two things are present at the same place, we would say that A in A samanadhikaran B, because samanadhikaran of A is present in B, because both are co-located and both are present at the same place. So the place which is actually where there is the mutual absence of sadhyavat, mutual absence of sadhyavat, in that place there shouldn't be the presence of hetu. And if this is the case, this definition is applicable to that. And here in the case of fire and smoke, this definition is applicable, and we can say that this is applicable to that example, and it fulfilling this criteria. And fourth explanation of this vyapti is sakala sadhya bhava nishtha abhava pratyogitva. So taking the help of Navyanyaya technical terms, we can understand this definition also. And the meaning of sakal means all. Sakala sadhya bhavavat. Whatever sakal means, all the locus or all the loci of sadhya bhav, absence of sadhya. So all the loci of sadhya bhav should be taken, and in all those locis of sadhya bhav, all those loci of sadhya bhav, there must be the absence whose pratyogita, whose counter positive is becoming our hetu, our province. If our province is becoming the counter positive of that absence which is present in all the loci of sadhya, all the loci of sadhya bhav, then we can say that this explanation is applicable to that inference, that hetu, and thus that hetu is considered to be a good hetu and sound inference. Like the example same here, we can see that the smoke is absent in all the places where fire is absent. It means the absence of smoke is present in each and every locus where there is absence of fire. So the same thing is required here, and we can see very easily that this hetu, this explanation is also applicable to the sound examples. fifth explanation of Vyapti is Sadhya Vadanya Vrittitva. And taking relational absence. So here in these explanations, we will discuss little. In this explanation, Sadhya Vadanya Vrittitva, it is said this fifth explanation is actually very much similar to the third explanation, and a part of first explanation is also similar to this definition, makes a part of this definition, explanation. So in brief, we can say that province, non-occurrence, absence in what is other than the locus of probandum is expected by this explanation. This is to say, the province should not be present what is other than the locus of probandum. So if whatever is other than the locus of probandum in any one of them, if hetu is present, then this explanation would not apply to that, and if it is not present there, this explanation applies to that. So in this case, we can see very easily that here in the same example, fire, smoke and mountain, fire is the sadhya, and what is the what is other than the locus of probandum? Probandum is fire. So what is other than the locus of sadhya is, are there are many cases, many things which are other than the locus of fire. Those are lakes, rivers, seas, etc. In all those places, in any one of these places, nowhere in those places smoke is present. Therefore, smoke is fulfilling the condition, and smoke should be understood as good hetu, good province, and therefore this inference is granted to be the sound inference. So these explanations, these five explanations are formulated by Gangesha Upadhyay in this regard. But why these are taken to be Purupaksha? It means there are some issues, there are some problems with all these definitions and explanations. Actually, there are certain cases, certain sound inferences are not covered by these examples, these explanations. And those certain examples are not covered. So let us take first that example, thereafter we will discuss why that is not covered. So the Nayayikas accept a special kind of inference which is known as Kevalanvayi. Kevalanvayi form universal positive inference. And the speciality of universal positive inference is that whatever is taken as probandum, it is present everywhere. So everything is the substratum of, everything is the locus of that probandum. And in all these examples, whatever example is formulated, whatever explanation is formulated of Abhyavicharatattva, there it was expected that there must be at least one place which is not the locus of probandum, or which is other than the locus of probandum. Without these two, none of these explanations is applicable. So here, in all these cases, if we take all these explanations, none of them would be applicable to this special kind of inference. And this special kind of inference, let us take one example of it, that is, it is nameable because it is knowable. So in this case, nameableness is taken to be sadhya, taken to be probandum, and knowableness is taken to be province. And we can see that everywhere there is nameableness is present, because everything is nameable, you will give a name to everything. So nameableness is present everywhere, and here in order to apply these explanations, there must be minimum one single case, one single thing which is not the substratum or the locus of nameableness. This is to say, there must be one thing which is not nameable. And it would be a contradiction saying that it is not nameable and you are talking, you are thinking about it. So, there will not be anything where which is the locus of absence of nameableness, and you cannot find that in that locus knowableness is absent. So this explanation, these all explanations fail to apply to this kind of inference. Therefore, Gangish leaves these definitions saying kevalan noini abhavat. These explanations of Abhyavichara Tattva should not be accepted because they are not applicable to kevalanvayi inferences. So he gives up all these issues. So there was a philosopher, Nayayika, who tried to solve, and this philosopher, this Nayayika, belongs to pre-Gangesh era of Nyaya philosophy, and whose name is known as Sundar. And he formulated something, he thought that if somehow we could discover the absence of sadhya, because there is no possibility of talking about the absence of nameableness. Because if you take nameableness, where this nameableness is present, so there is no locus of absence of nameableness. And actually, there is no absence of nameableness, because whenever you understand an absence, there is a necessity that two things must be understood. One is counter positive and another is anyogi, pratyogi and anyogi. So here, if you take the absence of nameableness, there won't be any anyogi of that absence. So because there is no anyogi of that absence, so you cannot find out, you cannot say that this is the place where there is no nameableness. This is not nameable, you cannot say. And Sundar thinks that if somehow we can discover that this is the locus of absence of sadhya, if we can show that this is the locus of absence of sadhya, then this problem will be solved. And he tried to discover another kind of absence which is known as vedhikarana dharmavachinna bhava. This is to say, in brief, a kind of inference whose counter positive is delimited by a property which is absent in that counter positive, which is not present in that counter positive. Vedhikarana, which this is to say, the counter positiveness and that property both are not present at the same place. And it is the accepted rule that these two should be present in the same place. Only then one should be the delimiter of that. Like when we say the absence of pot, so the potness becomes the delimiter of that counter positiveness which is present in pot, and in pot there is a counter positiveness, and in that pot there is a potness. Both are present in the same place, therefore potness becomes the delimiter of counter positiveness. But he discovers in a different kind of absence, which is actually vedhikarana dharmavachinna bhava. But Gangesha refutes this theory, proposal, simply saying that if we could somehow discover the absence of sadhya, it will not make our problem solved, because it is said that abhyavicharitattva is vyapti. Abhyavicharitattva means non-deviation. So deviation, absence of deviation is non-deviation. So what is the deviation? Deviation is the presence of hetu in the locus where sadhya is absent. The presence of provence in the locus where provendum is absent. This is actually called a deviation. And if you could somehow discover the absence of sadhya as vedhikarana dharma avachinna bhava, that will not make the problem disappear, because there will not be any deviation at all. You won't be able to find out deviation. And if deviation is not found, then there will not be non-deviation at all. So this proposal is also rejected by Gangesha. So avinabhav is vyapti. This is another way of explaining vyapti, that vyapti is avinabhava. This is also proposed by Gangeshopadhyay as purapaksha vyapti. Avinabhav is also understood vina na vinabhav, not being present without that. So you can say that if sadhya is not, hetu is not present without sadhya, there is avinabhav. But here, in case of Kevalanvayi, this avinabhava vyapti would also not be applicable. Therefore, this is also not siddhanta vyapti. It cannot be accepted. It is also purupaksha vyapti. It should be given up. So, to conclude all these explanations, we can say that the basic reason for giving up all these explanations of vyapti was the acceptance of universal positive inference. And if we don't accept the universal positive inference, the first or the fifth explanation of Abhyavichara Tattva would suffice to be a good explanation of vyapti. Raghunath Shiromani, the well-known commentator on Gangesha's Tattva Chintamani, actually did it. He suggested that there is no satisfactory ground for acceptance of universal positive inference. The universal positive inference can be understood in the terms of Anvaya Vyatireki inference, the positive negative inferences. Therefore, he preferred to accept the first explanation of Abhyavichara Tattva, that is Sadhya Bhava Davrittitva, as the nature of Vyapti. But in traditionally, these all are taken to be the cases of Purupaksha Vyapti. So, if you want to understand more, learn more, you may see the e-text and also learn more section of this video. Thank you very much for listening to me.